This is London, the home of Apple. The Apple concept is to bring together the artists of today with the methods and media of tomorrow. To do this, Apple has entered into many diverse fields of communication. Films, television, and of course records are all part of it.
What is Apple?
It's a company we're setting up which involves records, films, electronics, which make records and films work, and what's it called, manufacturing?
Yeah, it does a few things.
You know, the byproducts that end up with Larry Page t-shirts and that.
It's just trying to mix business with enjoyment.
Pleasure.
Because we're in business, you know, we find ourselves in business.
Are you the directors of this?
Like all the profits won't go into our pockets. They'll go to help people, but not like a charity.
We hope to make a thing that's free, where people can just come and do and record and not have to ask, could we have another microphone in the studio, because we haven't had a hit yet.
If you want it, here it is, come and get it. Make your mind up fast. If you want it, anytime I can give it, but you better hurry, cause it may not last.
I think the only plan for Apple was for it to be good music, and ideally music that maybe wasn't getting an opportunity to be heard other places. Paul asked me to be part of Apple Records pretty early on. First he asked if I would produce some records for Apple, because that's what I was doing at the time. I was newly anointed record producer and ex-artist. And then he later asked me if I would be head of A&R for the label. And I think the reason it ended up with such a very broad-based and eclectic collection of artists was because they came in from all different sources. There was Paul McCartney saying to Sam Mary Hopkin, or Ringo talking about John Taverner, John talking about his stuff with Yoko and other projects he had, George to bring Indian music, and Jackie Lomax and Doris Troy to everyone's attention. It really was a case, actually, of them having this extraordinary power and influence and using it pretty wisely. If somebody listened to the Modern Jazz Quartet or to Indian music who wouldn't have otherwise, that's a good thing.
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare,
Hare Krishna.
Suddenly he was a record company avowedly owned and run by these working class boys from Liverpool, who were determined that it wouldn't be as hidebound and as respect oriented and as boring as record companies were. So the difference at the time was total. I mean, it wasn't a partial, it was a massive change of concept and of pace and of style from how record companies were to what the Beatles wanted to make theirs into. I don't remember the exact order the people came in. Neil Aspinall, of course, was not brought in. Neil existed in the Beatles' lives and had done forever. He was kind of running the Beatles' affairs from being tour manager and kind of growing up to where the tour manager role became kind of a company manager and kind of managing director of the whole thing role. Derek Taylor was working for the Beatles before Apple. He's always been a PR genius and one of the most affable and entertaining men any of us have ever known. Quite brilliant. He'd been part of the Beatles' lives. It was inevitable he would become part of Apple's life. So his floor became the hub of the entertainment aspect of Apple and the sort of party aspect of Apple, it must be said as well. When you actually finish a day's work, you'd end up in Derek's office having a cocktail at the very least.
Hello. Apple, good afternoon.
And then a little later, I think, Ron Cass came in, because in the various discussions we'd had between myself and the Beatles, we all thought we needed a proper grown-up businessman who we all thought should be American, because we had this sort of respect for, oh, Americans really know what they're doing. And so we brought Ron Cass in to be the actual business head of the label. Well, it turned out, of course, that at Apple Records, going about attracting artists was not a task. Obviously, everyone in the whole universe wanted to be on Apple Records. It sounded so cool. It was the Beatles label. That's all you had to say. They did run the one ad with the picture of the one-man band saying, send us your tapes and things, and we got billions of them. The tragic thing is, of course, we never found anything through that route that was any good. Because, of course, that fell to my world as head of A&R. And quite apart from all the other ideas, which were usually funneled to Derek, the people who wanted money to levitate or something totally bizarre, how we signed each of the artists we did sign are each kind of separate stories, and actually each very different kinds of stories.
Something in the way she moves, looks my way, calls my name.